cry. Lord of all, to thee we raise this our hymn of grateful praise. For the wonder of each hour, of the day and of the night, hill and vale and tree and flower, sun and moon and stars of light. Lord of all, to thee we raise this our hymn of grateful praise. For the joy of human love, brother, sister, parent, child, friends on earth and friends above, for all gentle thoughts and mild. Lord of all, to thee we raise this our hymn of grateful praise. For thy church that evermore lifteth holy hands above, offering up on every shore her pure sacrifice of love. Lord of all, to thee we raise this our hymn of grateful praise. For thyself, best gift divine, to our race so freely given, for that great, great love of thine, peace on earth and joy in heaven. Lord of all, to thee we raise this our hymn of grateful praise. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Hey, good morning, everybody. I want to greet you in the love of the Lord as we gather together for worship, all in our separate places, but still gathering all over the world, all over Rice Lake, all over Barron County, all over everywhere. Christians are gathering this morning to praise God's name, and that is just a wonderful thing. I wanted to come to you this morning with a particular message. This message is a message that I actually thought long and hard about on whether or not I should share, because it shows a part of me that people don't usually see when we're worshiping on Sunday mornings, when we have various meetings and things like that, because I am the leader. I am the CEO of the church. I am the pastor. If your pastor doesn't have everything together, then who does? But in my conversations with people this week, I got the impression that I wasn't the only one feeling these things or this way. And so I just kind of wanted to put it out there as a word of hope for things. The challenge that we run across in these days and these places, in these particular environments, although the more that I think about it, it's not just limited to times of pandemic. This happens all the time. Various seasons hold various struggles, challenges, things that we must overcome, things that we must live through and live with. And for me, this last week, it was hard. It was really hard. And I just feel like overall, I was just sad. Just sad. And maybe the most hardest part about it was I couldn't particularly place what it was that I was feeling sad about. You know, you have all of these things that are going on, all of these situations that play into things. And when you begin to feel like that, you just want to lock down and point to this is what's wrong, so that you can fix it. So I started thinking about things. I started thinking, well, what could cause this? What could be the source of these kind of things? Is it anxiety over the state of the world and the way that things are playing out? I mean, we are experiencing a pandemic, for instance. That's tough. But I was thinking about it, and I was like, you know, I feel like I see it. I feel like I understand it, and it causes me anxiety and worry about the people I love and care for, but I don't think that's it. Not all of it. Then I started thinking about kind of the political fights that have been really popping up this week. I feel like this political fighting is ramping up. We're entering into a lesser known zone, a place of competition between ideals and what people think are really important to them, and that is heating up. And as it's heating up, you just see mean things being said, not just about the people who are leading these movements, but the people who are supporting them. You know, watching the Barron County Sheriff's Department post the update about the stay-at-home order this week on Facebook, and then reading the comments underneath, nasty things were being said. But I was thinking about it, and I was like, well, this isn't really anything new. As much as I hate to say it, people yelling at each other or saying nasty things or posting ugly pictures of people and whatever the case may be, that kind of thing, it just isn't new. And it does make me sad. I feel like I get a kick in the chest every time I see someone say something about somebody else that's just nasty. Not competing against views, not fighting for what you believe in, that we're supposed to do. But just being nasty and trying to tear someone else down, I'm not saying I don't do it. I'm not saying I don't think it. I am saying it makes me sad. But it's not new. It's not new to this time, to this place. And then I start thinking about the pressure that comes on living up to my call as a pastor, as a father, as a husband, as a person. You know, the drive to look at yourself in a time like this and say, look at this time that I have that's not bound by the normal routines and structures. I should be doing something with it. I look at myself every day and say, I've been trying to learn guitar for months now. This is the perfect time. I could be an expert by the time this pandemic stuff is over. And that and so many other things. You hear comments from people talking about how they know about a church somewhere that did something, and wouldn't it be great if ours did it? And you start to read those comments over and over and over again, and you just kind of feel like it's not enough. It's never enough. And am I living up to the best of my abilities, what it is that I can do? You just feel sad. All of these things, I think, play a part in it. I don't think it is any one thing. It's a feeling of stress and anxiety and feeling like you're not measuring up to what it is that you're supposed to do and what it is that you're supposed to be. And it's a challenge to our faith that we are who we're supposed to be. I've often wondered do I just have too sensitive a soul to exist in a world like this, where it seems to thrive off of violence and hate and pushing and pulling and knocking other people down. Maybe I just don't belong in a place like this. But like I said, in my conversations with people this week, I've gotten the very strong impression that I'm not the only one who feels this way. It reminded me of a story from when I was a kid. You see, I, probably no surprise to most people, I was the worst student who ever existed. I was smart enough to do all the work, but it was more fun to play with teachers, to play with rules, to play with the situation at hand. And in high school, I took French class. French, because that's how you get the ladies, right? You learn how to speak French. Well, it ends up that my attention to French wasn't what it should have been, and I was absolutely merciless with the teacher, always cracking jokes, always distracting the class, always just messing with things. And I remember one particular day, I was taking this test, and I hadn't studied for this test at all, and I didn't know anything, so I broke my pencil on purpose. And I take it up front, and I'm like, oh, I broke my pencil. I need a new pencil. And she looked exasperated, but she gives me a new pencil, and she's like, okay, just go do it. And I go back, and I immediately break that pencil she gave me. So I go back up, and I was like, I'm sorry, I can't take your test. I don't have a pencil. And she just flips out on me, like screaming at the top of her lungs, yelling, just absolutely tearing me a new one. And there's high school cocky young me, and I'm just like, it looks like I got run over by a dump truck. I'm like, what is happening? I'm scared. I'm literally frightened of my French teacher. And it was an experience. But I will never forget the next day going into class, and she takes me aside out into the hallway, and she says, and I'm expecting her to just tell me why I'm such a terrible student. She just looks at me and she says, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, I should not have yelled at you like that. I should not have lost control like that. But you see, this is the anniversary that my son died. And I just was feeling raw, broken, lonely. I lost control, and I shouldn't have done that. And that hit me harder than any of the yelling did. Obviously, I still haven't forgotten it. It reminds me that in a time like this, we all are carrying around a certain amount of stress and anxiety and fear that puts us in places, in compromised positions, where sometimes we don't act, even in our best interests. We just act purely off of the emotions that are driving us and running through our hearts. And we have to remember that the people around us are feeling and experiencing the same thing and push ourselves towards something better. I want to read you a reading from Scripture. This is from 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 9. All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is by His great mercy that we have been born again, because God raised Jesus Christ from the dead. Now we live with great expectation, and we have a priceless inheritance, an inheritance that is kept in heaven for you, pure and undefiled, beyond the reach of change and decay. And though your faith, God is protecting you by His power until you receive His salvation, which is already to be revealed to you in the last days for all to see. So be truly glad. There is wonderful joy ahead, even though you must endure many trials for a little while. These trials will show what your faith is genuine. It is being tested as fire tests and purifies gold, though your faith is far more precious than mere gold. So when your faith remains strong through many trials, it will bring you much praise and glory and honor on the day when Jesus Christ is revealed to the entire world. You love him, even though you have never seen him. Though you do not see him now, you trust him, and you rejoice with a glorious, inexpressible joy. The reward for trusting him will be the salvation of your soul. So even though we can't always see him, even though sometimes we are sad and we're hurting and we're feeling insufficient for the task, our hope is being kept safe by the infinite power of God. It's not up to me to protect it. It's not up to me to hold it and make sure that it's good enough. God is protecting me and loving me and watching over me and keeping me safe even in the moments when I know that I'm weak, as opposed to all the moments that I just am. Understand that this time that we're facing is a trial. But it's not just a trial for you. It's a trial for everybody. And our call in a place like this is to show compassion, to show love, to reach out as best we can and offer people an indistinguishable reason to know that they are loved. So like I said earlier, keep fighting for what you believe in. Go for what you know in your heart is right. But temper everything by following after God and what Christ would call us to do, which is the same that Christ did for us in the beginning. Out of our weakness, out of our hopelessness, out of our despair, he saved us. And he will save us from this. And he will save me from my sadness. And he will show true signs of love every day. Amen. I want to encourage us to do a time of prayer. In times of sadness, in times of reflection, it's important that we look to God for our hope, for our help, for what it is that we want to come next. So I want to encourage you to join in a time of prayer, to type down in the comments below prayer requests, things that are on your heart today that you would like to be prayed for, and you are more than welcome to ask for prayers for yourself. Lord God, please watch over me and bless me in this time is a great prayer to pray. I did want to lift up today Sam Zolik, because yesterday her grandfather, Larry Zolik, passed away, and he passed away peacefully, and he is with the Lord now, but that doesn't change, the pain and grief that, that I'm sure she is feeling and the rest of her family as well. Definitely, Michelle says prayers for the Osborne family at the loss of John Osborne. John, our brother in Christ, who we have been connected to for many, many years, passed away, and we're feeling that grief. But we definitely pray for the Osborne family during this time, and we hope that they are able to see the love of their brothers and sisters during this time. Yes, Jessica raises up all the teachers. Talk about uncertain times. Talk about doubting your own abilities. Teachers are reinventing the wheel, and I would like to say that they're doing a fabulous job. I haven't heard of any cases where I thought it was just bad. They're trying, And I think God is blessing that. So, but prayers for all the teachers and any sadness and self-doubt that they have during this time. My mom, pray for my husband and that I won't be weak at the same time. He's been very patient with me. Yes, that's, you know, in isolation with your family, and especially if you're feeling fears and anxieties kind of dumping in on you, you can have weak moments and just yell from the gut. And so I pray that people will be able to recognize those times before they say things they shouldn't. But also, grace is given when maybe we aren't the nicest. Molly, prayers for women who are pregnant and giving birth right now. It's kind of a scary time for a lot of unknowns. Also for new grandparents, aunts, uncles, siblings, cousins who can't meet with them. Yes, definitely. Molly, for those who don't know, is pregnant. And I'm sure she's seen firsthand a lot of challenges with things like this. Bill, healthcare workers risking all in their compassion. Yeah, definitely. Prayers of thankfulness for all those who are offering help to those in need right now. Healthcare workers, any sort of these essential workers and services being provided. Prayers, definitely. Definitely for those, and thankfulness and continued strength. For those who are unemployed and struggling financially, yes, definitely. You know, I was talking earlier about kind of the political infighting, and it's one of those things where I really do recognize why both sides of this debate about staying in lockdown and opening things up exists. Looking at people who are looking at loss of money and security and all those things, that stuff is so scary. And I wouldn't want that on anybody. So prayers definitely for those feeling that pinch and struggle. Susan, prayers to wisdom for our leaders. Prayers for church leaders. Support new ways to reach out to the congregation. Yeah, that's definitely true. Church leaders, much like I said for teachers earlier, are having to reinvent the wheel. So definitely prayers for them as well. Sam, who we prayed for earlier, says, for my cousin and his wife who have struggled to have a baby for 11 years and that they'll find a way to have that child. Yeah, those who struggle with fertility issues, talk about feelings of sadness, not being able to live up to a vision that you have for yourself. So prayers for those who are struggling with that today. Definitely. Thank you, Sam. Any others? I think there's a delay on these things, so I feel I don't want to jump ahead and miss somebody's prayer. But if I do, know that comments, prayers written down in the comments, just because I didn't read them out loud doesn't mean that they're not being prayed for. Let us come before the Lord in prayer. Lord God, I turn to you on this day, seeking after you in everything that we are attempting to do. Lord God, we often start, pandemic or no, with the best of intentions. And sometimes we act in fear and we isolate ourselves in ways that we didn't need to. Lord God, help us to not isolate ourselves from you. Help us to look towards you in the times when we are really struggling. Heck, help us look towards you in the times when we're doing just fine. Lord God, teach us to follow you in all of our pathways, that when we see someone who we believe is saying something just wrong, that we would not seek vengeance, that we would not seek to prove how they are not capable, but that we would speak with compassion, that we would speak with peace, that we would move and serve the world around us as you have served us. Lord God, may we see the ultimate example of your Son, Jesus Christ, and do everything that we can to emulate him. May we support those in our community who are suffering on this day, whether because they've lost their jobs, whether because they are just fearful for what is coming, or whether they're facing issues that even in this pandemic we can't foresee, like challenges conceiving a child, like conceiving a child, but not knowing how it works in a time like this. Lord God, may we open our hearts to the possibility that each and every person we see and interact with is struggling, and that they need to know, first of all, that they are loved. And Lord God, in the same way, as we hold that message in our hearts, may we continually remind ourselves that we are loved, and we are not alone, but we have the chance to be children of God. Help us. In all these things, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So, sometimes when I struggle, it is my way to fill myself up with God's grace. And my favorite way to do that is with songs, is with singing. If you see me driving around town, especially at this time, but pretty much at any time, you might just see my mouth wide open singing something. You are welcome to videotape that and put it on the internet if you want. It'll probably bring a smile to somebody's face. But I wanted to share a particular song. This is one that a lot of people know, so I invite you to sing along at home if you know the words. This is Because He Lives, a popular Easter song. And we are in the Easter season, but it reminds me that it's not all on us, that Jesus is with us and strengthening us for the road ahead. God sent his Son, they called him Jesus, he came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow, because he lives. All fear is gone, because I know he holds the future. And life is worth the living just because he lives. Peace be with you all this week. You're going to be hearing some stuff from me this week if you're a member of our congregation. Hopefully you're going to be getting a phone call from me this week. I do encourage you that if you are feeling sad, feeling a little beat up, to reach out to me. I am always ready to receive a phone call. I will always get back to you if I miss your call. And during a time like this, it's very important to reach out, if you even suspect that you need it. That's what I did, with my sadness. A lot of you, might be happy to know that I called David Butler this week and said, what the heck am I supposed to be doing? I called other people. You know, we're not in this by ourselves. You got to ask for help. So make sure you do that, whether to me or to someone else. You're welcome, because Christ welcomes us in. I hope you have an excellent Sunday. I hope you have a peaceful week. And I hope that you know that God loves you very much, because he lives. Peace.